Input sanitization and validation feels like a problem as old as programming itself. User input can't always be trusted, and ensuring it takes the exact form that we as programmers expect can take serious brain power. My name is Seb, and in today's Idiomatic Kotlin episode, we will tackle a challenge that's all about this topic. Day 4 of Advent of Code 2020. Stick around for the challenge and an elegant solution, implemented, of course, in Kotlin. Before we do that, however, with about 60% of our viewers not yet being subscribed to our channel, do consider hitting like, subscribing, and maybe even hitting the bell. Who knows? Let us set the scene for today's challenge with the scenario we find ourselves in. We're at the airport and it seems the passport scanners are malfunctioning. For us, this is both a curse and a blessing. If we get delayed, we might miss our flight. But we also forgot our correct travel papers, so maybe we can fudge the validation algorithm in our favor. For the full problem statement, visit adventofcode.com and look for day 4 2020 or follow the link in the description. If you want, you can even try your own hand at the problem before following along with our solution. So it's time to get hands-on and start building a passport scanner that actually works. The input as provided to us is a batch of travel documents in a text file, separated by blank lines. Each passport is represented as a sequence of key colon value pairs, separated by spaces or new lines. Our challenge is finding out how many passports are valid. For now, valid just means that they need to have all the required fields as outlined by the security personnel. Let's see if we can write up a solution for that in Kotlin. Like many challenges, we need to start by reading our puzzle input. Really, that's just a bunch of text in our input file. We then trim off any extraneous white space at the beginning and at the end of the file, just to make it all consistent. As per the description, passports are always separated by blank lines, and a blank line is just two returns or new lines in a row. So we'll use this to split our input strings into the individual passports. Note that depending on your operating system, the line separator in text files is different. On Windows, it's return and new line. On Linux and macOS, it's just a new line character. Thankfully, Kotlin's split method also takes an arbitrary number of delimiters, so we can cover both cases here directly. At this point, we have a list of strings, and each of those strings represents a single passport. However, I'm not a particularly big fan of just juggling lists of strings around in my program too much. The reason for that is that it can quickly get confusing, and we have a nice and expressive type system in Kotlin, so why not just use it at this point? Let's encapsulate the string in a very basic passport class, and map the results of our split up input to passport objects. Before we continue, a short aside. Like all Advent of Code challenges, this one also is a two-parter. It would be reasonable to assume that in the second part of the challenge, we may need to access the values of the passport fields and not just their names. However, there's a wonderful principle called YAGNI. You aren't gonna need it. Always implement things when you actually need them, never when you just foresee that you will need them. So, for the time being, let's implement exactly what has been requested of us. We want to count the passports that have all the required fields. From the problem description, we remember that within a single passport, key value pairs are either separated by spaces or new lines. So we can split once again, either on a space or when we encounter one of the new line sequences. Now we need to extract the key from each individual passport entry. We can do so by mapping our combined fields with values to only the substring that comes before the colon. We don't really care about the value that follows after right now. The result of our function will be whether the field names we extracted contain all required fields. Expressing that in Kotlin is almost how I just said it in words, using the contains all function. Field names has to contain all required fields. Now, bringing in the required fields is a matter of literally just typing them out in a list. Birth year, issue year and expiration year, height, hair color and eye color, passport ID and country ID. But since our own travel documents omits that last field, we're just going to conveniently ignore this in our validation as well. Finally, in our main function, we just need to count the passports for which our function has all required fields returns true. It's easy typing this out as a simple quick lambda, but if you want to be fancy, we can also use a function reference here. With that calculated number, we can go back to the challenge page and pick up our first gold star for the day 4 challenge of 2020, bask in the joy of having validated our first set of passports. Reflecting on our code snippet, I'd say that at this point we've arrived at a concise solution for the problem, which uses a lot of convenience functions offered by Kotlin Kotlin, and most importantly, one that returns the correct result. I'd call that an idiomatic solution in my book. But in classic AOC spirit, we are not done yet. Who would have known? Just checking whether all fields are present in a passport isn't actually enough. To earn our second star in part 2 of the challenge, we also need to make sure that the actual values contained in those fields are valid. To do so, we are once again given a list, now containing the rules of what is actually valid. Years need to fall into certain ranges, as does a person's height, depending on the unit. Colors need to either come from a pre-specified list or follow certain patterns, and numbers just need to have the right form. Before we start retrofitting this functionality on top of what we built so far, let's examine the structure of our code. Reflecting on it, maybe we can find some changes that will make adding this functionality easier for us. Recall that previously our passport class just stored a string directly, and we extracted the bits and pieces we needed to solve the first challenge on demand. At this point, we know that our passport class is going to need access to the different field names as well as their associated values. The classical data structure to store such kind of associative dictionary information is a map. So let's take the time and polish our existing code to store not just a normalized string, but a map of field names and their values. Intuitively, I'd say turning the string into the map is still a process that's associated with the passport. I like encapsulating such logic in a companion object factory function, which we can call fromString, and that gives us a nice and tidy way to construct passports. We already figured out how to normalize the input beforehand, so we can move our fields and values variable to this initializer. Because of our great naming skills, we can recall at this point that the fields and values variable holds a list of strings, each containing a field name and a value for that field separated by a colon. We can proceed with our intuition and split this into a list of pairs. We use a destructuring declaration first to assign the part before and after the colon to two variables, and then construct a pair using the infix function to. The toMap function then turns that into an actual map object with the first components of our pairs as the key and the second component as the value. But as you can see, this is where our good friend the IDE jumps in and lets us know that Kotlin can express this actually more simply. We can replace this call chain with the associate function. It does the same thing, but saves us the two-step process of mapping and converting and rolls it into one. Nifty. At this point, instead of wrapping a string, a passport now encapsulates a map of string keys and string values. So let's adjust that signature accordingly. With our reworked structure, we can take a hot minute to revisit and adapt the hasAllRequired_fields function. After our changes, this method turns out to be trivial. We can simply check that all required fields are contained in the key set of our map. Done, check mark. Let's actually move on to part 2. For the second part of the challenge, we consider a passport valid if it contains all the required fields and all fields have values that correspond to the official rules. Let's work out an approach to realize this in Kotlin code. Well, I've already set up part of our solution out loud. When you want to ensure that all fields have values that are validated correctly, we can use the all function to assert that a predicate holds true for every single key value pair in our map. Now we need to actually write up the logic for distinguishing different types of fields. The perfect construct for that in Kotlin is the when expression. In our case, we distinguish the different validation logic by the key, first of all. Now we just need to create branches for the different types of fields that need to be validated. Each of them needs to return a Boolean value. True if the field is okay, false if the field violates the rules. The surrounding all predicate will then use those results to determine whether the passport as a whole is valid. Let's whip up the individual field validation rules. Birth year, issue year, and expiration year all have very similar requirements. Their value needs to be a four-digit number falling into a particular range. Checking the length of four digits is quickly written up, and to check whether the numbers fall into the right interval, we parse the number using toInt or null and then use the infix function in together with a specified range to define the condition. This is actually a 2-for-1 because we automatically discard any values that aren't numbers and ensure that they fall into the correct range. A very similar validation rule with a minor twist is the passport ID. Since it's a 9-digit number with possibly leading zeros, we can break it down into two conditions as well. It has to have a length of 9 and it needs to be a valid integer. We don't need to make any assumptions about its actual value as long as these conditions are met. So while we could just call toInt or null on this as well, we can also just check whether all the characters of the input string belong to the set of digits. Validating iColor almost feels like a repeat of the first part of our challenge. We have a set of exact values, colors in this case, and as long as the value is contained within that set, we consider the field valid. So we just write out our Boolean condition. At this point, we have two more fields to validate, height and hair color. Both of them are a bit more tricky. Let's look at height first. This field can contain a measurement either in centimeters or inches, but depending on the unit that's used, different values are allowed. Thankfully, both cm and in are two-character suffixes, so we can once again use Kotlin's when function, grab the last two characters in the field value, and have multiple different types of validation logic, one for centimeters, one for inches, and one in case it's a unit we don't know. Because we want to validate the number, we need to turn it into an integer again. To do that this time, we need to get rid of the unit declaration. But that's no big feat, we just do that by removing the particular suffix and then checking once again whether we fall into the valid range as outlined by the challenge. That leaves us with only the hair color. Here we're expecting a hashtag followed by exactly 6 hexadecimal digits, so digits from 0 through 9 and then A through F. We could tweak our previous approaches with removing suffixes or prefixes and then parse the numbers somehow. After all, Kotlin can parse base 16 numbers into integers out of the box. Or to quickly show it off, we could use the sledgehammer method and introduce everyone's favorite method of validating patterns, regular expressions. Defining a regular expression in Kotlin is easy. Write it out in a string and then call two regex. I like using triple quoted strings because regular expressions tend to have a lot of control characters and it saves me from thinking about how to escape them. Now we can handcraft our regular expression. The pattern we are looking for is a hashtag and then exactly 6 characters from the group of 0 through 9, A through F. IntelliJ even gets us some nice little regex related syntax highlight. And as I've casually added it here, you can see that to check whether our string conforms to the regex, we can once again use a fancy infix function, this one called matches. For performance enthusiasts out there, a small aside, 2regex is a relatively expensive function. So in the interest of performance, you may want to move this function into a constant. The same actually also applies for the set of iColors, which is currently being initialized every time we test a field labeled ECL. The whole when block is used as an expression. That means the surrounding call to all relies on the value produced by this when block. Because of that, we need to make sure that all possibilities are covered. In our case, that just means adding an else branch, which simply returns true. Just because a password has a field we don't know about doesn't mean it can't still be valid. With that, we have covered every rule outlined to us by the problem statement, and all that's left is counting the passports that contain all required fields and have valid values. When we run the program, we end up with a resulting number which we can hand in, and lo and behold, we get another star. Security personnel are happy and we're clear for boarding our virtual flight. But something tells me that wasn't the last challenge that awaits us on this journey. To wrap up, let's briefly reflect on what we saw today. We wrote up a minimal solution to validate specific string information, which we were able to extract using the string utility functions offered by the Kotlin standard library. When the second part of the challenge was revealed, we reflected on our code and identified the map as a more fitting data structure than the string and changed our logic to accommodate it. We did that by introducing an elegant function to create passport objects from strings. By using Kotlin's when statement, we were able to keep the validation logic concise and all in one place. And when writing out those validation conditions, we saw more uses of the convenience functions Kotlin has to offer. Working with ranges, seeing if something is a part of a set or matches a particular regular expression. I think you'll find that many real-world applications have similar requirements for input validation, and we hope that some of the tips and tricks you've seen in the context of this little challenge will also be helpful when you need to write some validation logic on your own. As usual, thanks a lot to the folks behind Advent of Code, specifically Eric Wastl, who gave us permission to use the Advent of Code problem statements for this series. Check out adventofcode.com and continue puzzling on your own. And of course, subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell to get notified when we continue our idiomatic journey and more puzzle solutions are coming your way. Take care.